Demand for office space here in the Philippines seemed to improve this 2024. That's according to Colliers Philippines, as it expects companies to roll out their real estate plans this year after being put on hold due to the pandemic. Just how rosy is the outlook for the office space market? Let's ask our next guest, Michael McCullough. He's a managing director at KMC Savills. The office space market saw a turnaround beginning in 2022 after being hit by the pandemic. Since then, how has demand evolved?
Yeah, so we were lucky for 2023 to have a positive net take-up year. And we had roughly 80,000 square meters of positive net take-up. It's a little bit less than what we had in 2022. But we are expecting some stronger demand in 2024.
If we look at the gross numbers, did they actually pick up? And then you suffered from, say, increasing vacancies from companies that, occupied smaller spaces because of work from home.
Yeah, so in 2018, about 5-6 years ago, the market peaked in terms of take-up. Again, a lot of that was POGO and the Bay Area. And so when their leases came up for renewal after 5 years, which was last year, many of them right-sized or gave up some of that space to take, either a newer, smaller office in one of the newer, nicer buildings, or they stayed in the same building, but they gave back maybe a floor or two. So that put some pressure on the market last year. 2019, which is roughly 5 years ago, was also one of the kind of bigger banner years for real estate. And now this year, we'll see those five-year leases coming up. And so, those conversations around the renewals will be happening this year, and some will get back space. There is some hope that, the IT BPO sector does absorb some of that.
So speaking of the IT BPM industry, I mean, are they still the main growth driver for office space here, or, you have other growth drivers as well?
Yeah, they are the main growth driver. There's still some, quite a bit of local demand as well, which is good. It's maybe 20 to 30% of the market, given the sub-market. So, and the government is also taking office space as the government grows its services. So those are all good demand drivers, but it's largely led by the IT BPO segment. And more importantly, it's largely led outside of Metro Manila and some of the provincial areas, which is very good for inclusive growth for the country.
What about the POGOs? Are they still here or have they kind of disappeared?
They are still here. It'll be interesting to see what happens. There's a lot of political pressure on which POGOs should be here. I think we all have heard or read some of the horror stories, but there are also a lot of legitimate gaming companies which are registered in the UK or US, and the Philippines is still a great back office for some of these types of clients.
So a while ago, you talked about expansion outside of Metro Manila. Maybe you can talk more about the locations that are preferred by these IT BPM companies.
Sure. I mean, part of the strategy for some of these companies is to be where the talent is. And they really want, they don't want to be fighting, they don't want to be in salary wars and bonus wars with some of their competitors. So they're going to go to places where maybe they're the first one there. That gives them, that makes them the employer of choice automatically. They're the only ones hiring in that town. Places like Dumaguete, which, already has a maybe small BPO segment there, but further up north, Poro Point and Lo Union, for example, Antipolo, outside of Davao even. So we're going to start seeing contact centers and the BPO industry pick locations that we're probably not that familiar with. And they're going to be where the talent is, but where they have no competition.
So a while ago, you were talking about, supply also being a problem. Are we still going to suffer from oversupply this 2024? And when will that oversupply problem end to the point that, we'll finally see lease rates going up again, right?
Yeah, so that's a good question. There is a lot of supply. Developers still want to build. That's what they know. That's what they love to do. There is a chance for them to be successful because they are building better quality office stock. Many of it is, green or certified green. So, under LEED or or Verde, and that is attracting the best tenants in the market. So their buildings are built, you know, kind of in the post-COVID era. They have high quality air control and ventilation systems, better, more sustainable materials. Those are all things that today's office market is looking for. So they will be successful, particularly in the upper segment that wants and demands these things. Multinationals, for example, some of the more prestigious, even local companies are looking for that.
So if you're a property company with an old building, what should you do?
You know, there's buildings that are probably 20 years old that are just almost not even marketable anymore. It's going to be a real tough decision for a landlord to say, wow, I've got a 20-year-old building. Nobody's interested in it. I've only got maybe the ground floor leased out. What do I do? Do I tear down? Do I retrofit it? My personal suggestion would be to look at retrofitting. It's much quicker. It's not that much. I mean, it's expensive. Everything you do is going to be expensive, but sitting on an empty asset is also probably expensive. So my initial reaction is to look at retrofitting it.
You know, I mean, the Philippines is pretty lucky because, you know, other countries are suffering from, you know, lower office demand. At least we're still seeing the demand increasing here. What is your advice for the Philippines to keep the momentum going?
You know, the government's kind of needs to be out of our way sometimes. They had this PEZA versus BOI rift. A lot of the contact centers and BPOs went started to look at BOI that allowed them to locate anywhere in the Philippines and still get some of the tax incentives. And then there was PEZA that was saying, well, we'll only give the tax incentives if you work in certain PEZA locations. Again, two buildings could be right next door to each other, 1 foot away. One is PEZA, one is non-PEZA. I don't know if that was the intent and purposes of PEZA when it was created 20-something years ago. So the government really has to kind of have an alignment in terms of the incentives. We need to make it easy to do business and hire super talented Filipinos that actually want to work. And there's plenty of work to be done globally. The U.S. is having a bit of a recession, and that whole return to office thing that they're trying to roll out is not rolling out, and that's crippling the commercial real estate industry in the U.S. Not so much like the Philippines, we're somewhat immune to that. We don't have big offices in our condos or even in our homes. That does force people to come to an office a bit more than some of the other, you know, Western societies.
So with that, thank you very much for your thoughts about the Philippine office property market. And I wish you the best of luck, and hopefully, vacancy rates go down.